Welcome to another session by the Association of Future African Neurosurgeons. I am Ivan Zolo. I'm a final year medical student from Cameroon and the president of the Association of Future African Neurosurgeons. It's a pleasure to have you here tonight. So today we are going to have a presentation on our neuro-oncology case series by Dr. Hugh, who is from Morocco. But before you go to the presentation by Dr. Hugh, I'm going to ask each panelist to introduce themselves. We're starting with Dr. Daniel Iyamba, please. Can you unmute yourself and present yourself?
So, hello, everyone. So my name is Daniel Iyamba from DRC. I'm a general practitioner from Initiative Hospital in Kinshasa. So, that's it.
Thank you very much, Dr. Daniel. Next on the list is Danny Kambole. Please, can you unmute and present yourself?
Hello, everyone. My name is Danny Kambole. I'm a fifth year medical student, Copper Belt University, Zambia.
Thank you very much. Next is Arsene Nyalunja.
I'm Arsene Daniel from the Democratic Republic of Congo. It is a pleasure to be a part of this panel today.
Thank you. Next is Shibuike. Please, can you unmute and present yourself? All right. Before we step out, next is David Orick. Please, can you unmute and present yourself?
Hello, everyone. I am David Orick Dale. I am a third year medical student in Russia, and I'm equally the head of communication department in Japan. Thank you. Glad to be here.
Welcome and happy birthday.
Thank you.
Next is Darwin Sishimba. Please, can you present yourself?
Hello, everyone. Good evening. Good afternoon. Good morning to everyone. My name is Darwin Sichimba. I'm a fifth year medical student from Copper Belt University, and I'm the director of operations for the Association of Future African Neurosurgeons, and I'm glad to be here this evening. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next is Leslie Jogo. Please, can you present yourself? I'll probably step out. Okay, Leslie, go on.
Okay, good evening, dear all. My name is Jo Leslie. I am a fourth year medical student at the Garoua Faculty of Medicine in Cameroon. I am very honored to follow you every Saturday. Thank you.
Welcome. Next is Dr. Marco Meloni. Please, Dr. Marco, please, can you present yourself?
Good afternoon. My name is Marco Meloni. I'm a consultant neurosurgeon in Gravedona, Italy. Nice to see you.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to have you around, Dr. Marco. Next is Katib Lasisi. Can you present yourself?
Hi, everyone. I'm following you from Dakar, Senegal. I'm a medical doctor and glad to be here. Thank you.
Oh, fantastic. Thank you. It's the first time to have somebody from Senegal. You are honored. Thank you very much. And next is Olaoluwa Ezekiel. Please, can you present yourself?
Hi, everyone. I'm Olaoluwa Ezekiel Dada. I'm a second year medical student from the University of Ibadan, Nigeria. I'm also a member of the operation department, HAFAN. Glad to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Takutin Bejo. Please, can you present yourself?
Greetings, everyone. I'm Takutin Dogmo Bejo, city medical student.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much. And last but not least, please, Dr. Hugh, you have the floor. Please present yourself and go on with your presentation. Thank you.
Okay, thank you all. Thank you, Zolo. I'm Dr. Hugh from the Republic. I'm undergoing training in Morocco for neurosurgery. Okay, today, we talk about the fifth case. So let me share my screen. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. And I will go on with the case without any other formality. Today's case is about a 40-year-old woman with a complaint of hair loss, weight gain, acne, easy bruising, generalized weakness, and facial hair for 5 years. All dramatically worsened over the last year. She has lost hair at the top of her head and gained 30 pounds in the past year. Progressive weakness in most notable while climbing stairs and carrying groceries. When the systems are reviewed, there was positive. It was positive for galactorrhea, dysmenorrhea, darkened skin, heart palpitation, frequent oral stress, and occasional mild headache. Her past medical history was about hypertension in the past year and hypothyroidism requiring replacement for 8 years. On the physical examination, the patient, we found a patient with a central obesity with a fat hump between the shoulders, thin asymmetries, scatters, ecchymosis, facial and back acne. The lower and upper extremity strength was a little bit lower, and it was about 4/5. With an unstable gait. The remainder of the physical examination was normal. So this case was posted on the panel also it was sent to everyone. So I would like to know, when you read the case, what do you think about? What diagnosis? What kind of diagnosis do you think of when you look at this? This patient's case, these signs and symptoms of this patient. As a discussion, so anyone can talk and go on. Hello?
Yes, Dr. Hugues, there's some people who are raising hand. Taku Singh raised their hand.
I cannot see them. Let me see. Okay. Oh, yeah, go ahead, Taku Singh.
Okay, thank you very much for the floor. Thank you very much for presenting this beautiful case. The presentation, my diagnosis here is Cushing syndrome. Signs and symptoms of autism. That is, the patient had acne, hypertension.
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, yeah. So thanks a lot for this presentation, or for the presentation of the clinical presentation aspect. So I think this case is a Cushing syndrome. So with the initial imaging, we probably need to find out the source of the source of the adrenal corticotropic hormone. So, but the primary diagnosis is Cushing syndrome, and then we need to go further to get to the definitive diagnosis.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that was what Benjo was saying. I heard him very well. He was talking about Cushing syndrome also. Well,
yes, Dr. Daniel Yamba raised the hand too. Dr. Daniel, you can go on.
Hello?
Okay, now you can get to Dr. Daniel. Go on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah. I think it can be a pituitary gland tumor related to the centrum.
Okay. Thank you.
Can I say?
Yes, Dr. Marco, go on.
Okay. Yeah, I totally agree with the Cushing syndrome diagnosis. I think the first of all, I will do is to have a blood examination for a adrenocorticotrope hormone, because if you got a high ACTH, you probably need to fight to search for. Hypophysis adenoma, ACTH cessament. On the contrary, if you got a low dose of ACTH, probably you need to find for surrenal glandular tumor.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you all for your interest and your intervention about the diagnosis and what should be done next. Let's continue with the case. And I think all of you are in. And about this case, we could think of the primary disease that can I can think of is the tumor. Which kind of tumor is Cushing disease? Cushing disease, which is the Cushing syndrome, but due to pituitary adenoma coming from the central part. So it could also be adrenal adenoma or carcinoma. So secondarily, the patient can have metastasis of another of a primary tumor on from another organ to the pituitary gland. It could also be ectopic adenocorticotropin secreting tumors, mostly from the lungs, and other iatrogenic or patient has injected a high dose of corticosteroid. All these are possible cases, diagnoses that we can get from the history of the patient. From that on, it have been done head MRI to check. I'll just remind that when we talk about the pituitary adenoma that is beginning a high dose of adenocorticotropin hormone, most time is a micro adenoma, and the micro adenomas are very tiny. By definition, they are about 10 millimeters in diameter. It's not big, it's just small, which makes it very tiny that at times you cannot even find it on the MRI, you know. And mostly when it's less than 6 millimeter, it's very, very difficult to find on the MRI. So about this patient, what we notice here is that this is the CT scan, corona session, T1 weighted, injected T1 weighted. And what you can see here, you see, there is this, this is the carotid artery, the right carotid artery and the left carotid artery on both sides of the cavernosinus. And then you can see the left carotid artery has a little bit higher diameter compared to the right one. The right one, the lumen is become smaller, which means there should be something there making an effect of a mass effect on this artery. So also the intensity of this left right side is not the same as the left one. So our microadenoma should be at this right side of this right side of the pituitary gland. What to be shown other one is to show you to confirm what I just said now. You can see the pituitary stalk, which is going up, and is slightly bent toward the left side. You can see it as I'm showing. This pituitary stalk should not need to be white, needed to be straight, but it's bent a little bit towards the left side. So that means the adenoma, which is on the right cavernosinus adenoma, is having this pituitary adenoma is having an effect on the pituitary stalk. Also, we can see if you can see it, there this horizontal line on top of the pituitary stalk. On this image is well seen. This horizontal line over here also you can see this horizontal line. This horizontal line is the optic. This is the chiasma, and you know the chiasma is when it's normal. It's normal position. It should draw this line. In case the chiasma is compressed by the tumor, or in case the tumor having a mass effect on the chiasma, this chiasma will show right arm, left arm, and point upward. Then MRI. Okay, there. Not too much, just to confirm the existence of the tumor on the right side here. And that's it. So there are some other tests that have been carried on, like electrolytes, which was electrolyte test, endocrine panel, CT scan, and the chest CT and chest CT scan for chest and the abdomen to check if there's no other primary tumors somewhere else in the body that metastasize to. I don't know, pituitary, or to check if there's no adenoma tumor. As Dr. Marcos Melani just said now, there might be something happening in the suprarenal area and having this adrenal adenoma and may cause this disease. So this CT scan for chest and abdominal is done for to check on all those things. The low dose dexamethasone suppression test also is carried out for this patient. High dose dexamethasone suppression test are carried out also. And the inferior petrosa sinus sampling. The dexamethasone test is to, the dexamethasone test and the inferior petrosa sinus sampling are tests that are done to confirm the hydrocorticotropin hormone, the high dose secretion of this hormone, and mostly to find out if this secretion is from the pituitary gland or is from the adrenal gland in the peripheral. Let me explain a little bit about this test before coming back to the results. There are mainly three tests according to literature that are mostly done. We don't do all of them in our clinics, but I will talk about that. The first one is to check the urine free cortisol collection. That one we do it frequently for this patient. We collect the urine for 24 hours and we check if there's cortisol in the urine. The second one is to do this a low dose dexamethasone suppression test. So what we are doing is we are giving to the patient 1 milligram of dexamethasone around 11 p.m. And then we withdraw blood for lab tests around 8 a.m. We send to the lab, and in case the cortisol in this sample is less than 1.8 milligram per deciliter, that means there's lack of suppression, which means the secretion of the hydrocortisone, the hypercortisolemia, is not from the central part, but it's from the periphery. The third test is about the salivary test that can be done around 11 p.m. and midnight. So when we do this test, the remaining question to solve is whether the secretion is from the pituitary or the peripheral. But these tests allow us to confirm the hypercortisolemia. And Before I come to both central or peripheral production of the hypercortisolemia of the hydrocorticotropic hormone, let me explain to you a little bit anatomically. You should know that the cavernous sinus is drained to the jugular vein by the inferior petrosa sinus. Okay, and what is done is that there is about this. How to call this petrosal is shown here, the inferior petrosal sinus sample. Wait. Yeah, so this inferior petrosal sinus sample is what is a test that is done to confirm that the hydrocorticotropic hormone secretion in this patient is from the pituitary gland, pituitary adenoma. And we just catheterize the femoral veins bilaterally and continue and get to the right and left petrosal sinus through the jugular vein. And at that level, the adrenocorticotropic hormone is measured. And what we got should be compared to what is gotten from the peripheral test, from the peripheral measurement of the adrenocorticotropic hormone. The number one the result that will draw our attention to confirm that this production is from the from the pituitary adenoma is when we have a peripheral ratio of 2-1, while the petrosal sinus sample is 3-1. For example, the result that is showing in this patient, from all that have been said, come to this two down line, you see that you have 26-1 for the peripheral ratio and 49-1, which means our production is truly from the pituitary adenoma. The other test results, the morning cortisone is higher than normal, is 29 in this patient. What else to mention here? To mention the chest and the abdominal CT scan is shown the 1 centimeter left adrenal mass consistent with a system for adenoma. And I've explained already about the inferior petrosa sinus sampling. So once this is confirmed, when we've got our image, what should be done? We should carry on surgery to remove this pituitary adenoma. And I would like to remind that the size of the pituitary adenoma has nothing to do with the amount of hormone for production. It might be tiny, maybe even less than 6 millimeter, and produce a lot of adrenocorticotropic hormone and show in the patient with signs and symptoms that we just discussed, which I will add for our own information and our own medical culture to know that this adrenocorticotropic hormone is doing what exactly in the patient: hypertension, diabetes, osteoporosis, weight gain. I think that does it. Hypertension, diabetes, osteoporosis, weight gain, and amyotrophy. Yeah, that's the five things that we should have in mind. That are very bad about this high level of adrenocorticotropin hormone. So this is why this patient needs to be operated. We need to remove. We go ahead and operate and take out this pituitary adenoma, as tiny as it is, and it's done. The gold standard of the surgery of this adenoma is transsphenoidal surgery, the surgery of choice. And this is passing through the nostril and get to the sphenoid sinus, to the pituitary gland and remove the adenoma. I will show it in detail in the next slide. So for patients that who have failed other surgical and medical options, bilateral adrenalectomy have been an option in this patient. So this is removal of the adrenal cortex and adrenal medulla in this patient. So some authors have described also ME resection of the adrenal cortex in some patients. I mean, the patients have been operated and still signs and symptoms are still there. The patient is suffering for these symptoms, the anxiety symptoms, so you can go ahead and remove the organ that is responding. Because when this hormone, adrenocorticotropin hormone, is produced from the pituitary gland, the responding organ is for the hypercortisolemia is this adrenal cortex. So some authors has proposed to remove it when surgery is done and still patient is suffering. Medical treatment is also an option, and all those drugs can be used to treat the patient. Also, stereotactic radiation have been used. External beam radiation therapy also has been used. We cannot talk about the surgical technique without mentioning this great guy, this great ancestor. And when I read about this, anything about the pituitary gland, you have to find his name. You will definitely see his name. This is Harvey Cushing. I'm not talking about the tall guy. I'm talking about the guy standing with the hand in his pocket. This Harvey Cushing. He had a great interest in this all concerning about pituitary gland, pituitary adenoma, and micro and macro adenoma, and all about pituitary gland. So, about the techniques, I don't know if we can discuss a little bit about how people operate in their service. Dr. Marco Meloni is here, so he can share with us a little bit about this his experience. Before I continue, and if any other person also has experience of he has seen or he has operated about this case, we can listen to him also. Please, you have the floor.
Oh, sorry, can you repeat?
Yeah, I was talking about the surgical techniques that I want us to discuss a little bit. The experience that each and everyone has about surgical techniques, how we've seen the operation going on, how do we carry on the operation for this transferoidal or any other approaches for about the macroadenoma?
Personally, is an over speciality the transfemoral surgery, and I don't have a personal experience. I participated a lot of operations during my residency. The most important thing to take in consideration is the anatomy of the internal carotid, because is your landmark and a very treat to take in mind when you perform this operation.
Okay, sir. Okay. Okay, thank you. We're taking that to your attention. Well, so we should be careful about the internal carotid. We see it just now, you're absolutely right. So the patient should be positioned supine by 10 degrees. This position is called a transatlantic position. And the patient is bringing his ear down to the shoulder away from the surgeon. You know? And it can be held by Merfield also. The sphenoid sinus is assessed endoscopically through the expansion of both sphenoid ostea behind the middle turbinate. The oscillum of the sphenoid sinus and posterior bony septum are removed to provide an adequate working channel. And this is how it looks like. And we coagulate. When we get into the nostril, we coagulate and do incision in the anterior submucosal tunnel. Once it is done, this septum will be shifted and to allow resection of this septal bony structure, and we will have easy access and free access to the sphenoid bone, to the sphenoid sinuses, as is shown in this figure, because the adenoma is up here. I mean, after the sphenoid sinus, we will find the floor of the cavernous sinus, which holds the adenoma. So once it's done, this is the coronal view. Once it's done, we will have something like this view. It's a great view. I will show it more in detail with a perioperative picture. So what is done is you navigate through the nostril, you find out the middle turbinate, the superior turbinate, over here the middle and the inferior turbinate. So you navigate inside the nostril to confirm your position of the middle turbinate, because this is the one that are going to guide you to get to start your operation. And then you get inside, you locate your middle turbinate, you will go ahead and coagulate the septal mucosa. Once it's coagulated, the coagulation is done with the resection of the septal mucosa, and it will be opened. We saw it on the image I just shown before here, and this will be open like a window. You can see that the incision is not to the floor of the ethmoid bone, not to injure the olfactory nerves. So on the other side, the same thing will be done, and it will be open to get to the posterior septal mucosa. Once this is open, you will get access directly to the bony structure of the sphenoid sinus. So as you have seen now, that's the bony structure that will be removed. And when it's removed, you have access to this cell floor. That's the cell floor you have seen. Let me go ahead and show you how it looks like. So this is it, the cell floor. It's like a mountain relief. when you look at it very well, there's a depression down here. This depression is bringing you directly to the clivus, you know, the anterior part of the clivus. So when you see this depression, that means you go up a little bit, you get to the cellar floor. By the side, in front of the depression, as Dr. Marcos Melani just said now, you have to be careful with this carotid. This is the carotid process that is here, on the left side here. And up, you have the optical carotid complex. Optical carotid complex that is up here, what I'm showing, the OC. And the main thing here is to look for this depression that shows that you have the clavius, and up to the clavius, you are on the cellar floor. This mucosa of the cellar floor will be open, will be removed, and maybe used later for closure, and then you get to the bony structure that will be removed. When the bony structure is removed, you will see the tumor. Wait, let me bring back. So you can see when the exactly. So when the bony structure is removed, the cellar floor is removed. Sometimes the tumor can infiltrate the cellar floor and it's tiny already. So a little bit, you take the caisson, you can easily be taken off the caisson, and you get to find out the structure that is the adenoma in our case. So what are the complications and that can be avoided? How to manage them? The first complication is the postoperative endocrine management. Postoperative low or high secretion of the hormones. So the drop of in cortisol level may be observed postoperatively. Patients should be closely monitored in case of abnormalities. In case of diabetes insipidus, which is the high production of urine that is clear, low density, patients need to monitor vasopressin in that case. And it can also show an inappropriate production of the vasopressin hormone. There can be also hypocortisolism in some patients. In case we have insulin, we have diabetes mellitus in some patients, insulin can be required to treat these cases. There can be also CSF leak in some patients. Once if it's observed intraoperatively, more consultation should be done in this patient. Over here, perioperatively, we do what is called the Vasava maneuver to control, to check the CSF leak in intraoperatively. And if it doesn't leak, that means we can close it and leave the in case the CSF leakage happens. So promoters propose lumbar drainage, and the CSF leak is first detected postoperatively. If detected postoperatively, it should be closely monitored. In case the leakage is large, it's large amount of CSF of cerebrospinal fluid that leaks from the operating field, that means we should take the patient to the operating theater to reconstruct the cellar that have been opened. I want to share with you this case of our service, a very interesting case. This is a patient of 47 years old. Just how the disease, how this Cushing disease can be very dramatic. That's what I want to share with you. So you can see in 1999, this is how this beautiful lady was. You know, this is how you can see the picture. She was slim, wealthy, it was okay, 1999. But she found out that she had been adding weight, scapular hump, difficulty of walking, diabetes, hypertension. And she got to our service in 2007, and was diagnosed for microadenoma. She was operated, put under drugs, and in 2019, I mean, about 12 years later, this is how her signs and symptoms have been resolved. She lost weight. She was followed by endocrinologists. Everything was become mostly okay once it could be her. But rather unfortunate, this will not last longer. In 2020, this is how she came back again. With this, we complain of heaviness. She's been very tired, and she's been very. The weight gain was about 70 kg. She had gained in the lifetime of 7 years. 7 years. We did this MRI centered on the pituitary gland, which is shown this structure, this lesion on the right side. You can see this tiny lesion on the right side of the cavernous sinus. It was shown here, marked around this lesion was about 6 times 7 millimeter in size. You can see it here. And also, as I mentioned on the other figure, on that image, you can see this patient didn't complain about blurry vision or visual problem, visual defect. Because of what you can see very well that the chiasma that is horizontal here is not compressed. The tumor is not large enough to raise or to compress to have a mass effect on the chiasma. You can see it very well here. The chiasma is horizontal, that means it's normal, is not having touched by the tumor. So this patient has been operated, just to show more how it looks like this microadenoma on this second image. So on February 16th, we took her second resection of this recurrence of microadenoma. And this is how she was looking when she was at the immediate post-operative period. She had been addressed to the endocrinologist once more to continue the follow-up. The reference that we used to prepare this presentation, and thank you for your attention. And any comment and suggestion can be welcome to bring up this betterment of this work. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hugh, for the wonderful presentation. Thank you so much for the detailed presentation. So as Dr. Hugh said, if you have any comment from Dr. Kabulo, I'd like to acknowledge his presence, though he just came in, maybe you can just give any comment on this presentation, Dr. Kabulo.
Thank you so much, Zolo, and hello to everyone. Hello to our senior, Dr. Marco Meloni. I can see him online. Thank you so much. Sorry, I just joined the meeting. I missed most of it. So you can carry on. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much. Thank you. So I don't know if you have any comment or remark from the panelists. All right. If not, then we can... okay. So for tuning, Gang Pe has a question. Please, you can go and ask your question, please.
Okay, thank you very much. Hello, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Yik Dopun, for your presentation. Very nice. I have a comment about your picture or the MRI. When you were showing the MRI, you said that the pituitary adenoma have a mass effect on the carotid, so that is this lead to the side of the micro the platinoma. I'm not sure that the benign adenoma, even if macro of micro adenoma, reduce the diameter of the carotid artery. If the adenoma reduce the diameter of the carcinoma. It's not a simple adenoma. It's a, maybe an invasive adenoma or carcinoma or another pathology. So be careful about that notice. So I'm not sure that is a real reducing of the diameter of the carotid. Maybe it's the artifact or something something else. So okay. Be careful of that. I don't understand really what we can do when we have when we suspect a adenoma in a patient. Can you explain me?
Okay, is that all? Is that okay? Or there's another point?
Yeah, yes. My last question is: what was the histopathology of your patient? The adenoma of your patient you operated this year, last time. The patient you present.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. What we've done when we suspect from a patient that is having signs and symptoms of Cushing disease, the cortisol, blood cortisol level, the cortisolemia is should be checked. And that's what was done in this patient. And the patient was having high level of cortisol, high hypercortisolemia of 29, as you can see from the normal range. And adenocorticotropin hormone also have been almost 10-fold higher than the normal. The prolactinemia also is high, the electrolytes, but the electrolytes are, the test is normal. So these are the tests that should be done in those in the patient when you suspect Cushing disease. I mean, even Cushing syndrome, and then the called Cushing disease, then you confirm if this production, this hyperproduction of these hormones, is it coming from the sensorial part of the, is it coming from the pituitary gland, or is it coming from just, is a local secretion from adenoma, or is coming from patient has ingested a high dose of corticoid. So those are the three things that I've talked about and that should be done. In our case, the patient having high level of cortisol, high level of adenocorticotropin hormone, and we've confirmed with the inferior petrosa sinus sampling that the patient's a production of the hypercortisolemia is from the pituitary gland. And then the MRI come to confirm that at the pituitary gland, at the level of the pituitary gland, there is truly a lesion and a macroadenoma at this level. So that was the steps that have been followed to manage this patient. About the patient that I presented, the question was about to know was the histological sample, right? Mm-hmm. Is it the histological sample? I didn't show it. I have it somewhere in my document. I didn't show it. The histological sample confirmed the macroadenoma. That was it. It wasn't something else. And the histological sample that we did was for the first one. Oh, sorry, I have the result of the second one because I wasn't there when the operator when she underwent a surgery in 2007. The one we did in February, I have the result and confirmed that this is not something else, but is the macroadenoma, huge macroadenoma. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Who is the chief neurosurgery? Who is the chief of department for the neurosurgery department in the Hassan CHU Morocco? Thank you very much for that, for those questions and comments. And thank you, Dr. Hugh, for the amazing responses. So thank you all for coming today, and
looking forward to having you during our next presentation. I think next week we have the presentation by the Young Cans, if I'm not mistaken. So we might not have a new oncology case next week, but we still have to confirm. So thank you very much for all for coming, and see you next time. Bye-bye.
Okay, thank you.
Bye.